Good morning, very warm welcome to you as we gather for our harvest celebration. Sean is really sorry not to be with us. He and the family are unwell this moment. It's not COVID, they're just unwell with seasonal illnesses. So we do hold them in our prayers. So I'm leading us through our service this morning, and we'd be really welcoming Kate Howard as she comes and shares with us as she brings us God's word today. But as we come, thank you so much for all those who have decorated the church, ready for our harvest celebration, for those who have brought some food and goodies for the besom. If you've already got those, I encourage you after the end of the service simply to bring them up and to lay them up here, and then they will all be passed on and make that difference into those lives of so many families who just find it hard this time of year and throughout the year. So a very warm welcome to you all as we come together for worship. As we go through our service, all you need will be up on the screens for us. I'll be leading us through the yellow type font. If you'd like to respond with the bold white type font, that would be really lovely. So as we gather, let us stand. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. Then shall the earth bring forth her increase, and God, our own God, will bless us. Remain standing as we come together, singing that great hymn of praise on this harvest celebration. We plough the fields and scatter. As we stand, let us pray. Let us give thanks to God for the colour and forms of your creation and our place within it. We bring our thanks, good Lord, for our daily food and for those whose work and skill bring your good gifts to us. We bring our thanks, good Lord, for the gifts and graces inspired in human minds and hearts, for insight and imagination. We bring our thanks, good Lord, for new hope and strength in our communities, especially in your church and among all you call to serve you. We bring our thanks, good Lord, for all in whose lives we see goodness, kindness, gentleness, patience, and humility, and for all the fruit of the Spirit. We bring our thanks, good Lord, for the life we have been given, and for all those whom you have given us to share it. We bring our thanks, good Lord. Your mercy endures forever. I'd like to please be seated. Let's take a moment to reflect not only on all that's been brought in to be shared through our harvest this year, but for all that beauty of creation we see around us and the joy of God's creation and harvest to us all. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. You bring forth bread from the fields and give us the fruits of the earth in their seasons. Accept these gifts, which we bring before you, made from the harvest of your goodness. Let it be for us a sign of your loving care. Blessed are you, Lord our God, worthy of our thanksgiving and praise. Blessed be God forever. And so we come into our time of confession, a time when we may pause and remember those things that we've done and said that have been wrong, those things that separate us from one another and from God. And on this harvest, let us also pause and remember how so often we have so much and are plentiful, and yet there are so many who simply go without. God our Father, we are sorry for the times when we have used your gifts carelessly and acted ungratefully. Hear our prayer, and in your mercy, forgive us and help us. We enjoy the fruits of the harvest, but sometimes forget that you have given them to us. Lord, in your mercy, forgive us and help us. We belong to a people who are full and satisfied, but often ignore the cry of the hungry. Lord, in your mercy, forgive us and help us. We are thoughtless, and at times do not care enough for the world you have made. Lord, in your mercy, forgive us and help us. We store up goods for ourselves alone, as if there were no God and no heaven. Lord, in your mercy, forgive us and help us. The Lord enrich you with his grace and nourish you with his blessing. The Lord defend you in trouble and keep you from evil. The Lord accept our prayers and absolve us from our offenses. For the sake of Jesus Christ, our Saviour. Amen. Let us pray. Creator God, you made the goodness of the land, the riches of the sea, and the rhythm of the seasons. As we thank you for the harvest, may we cherish and respect this planet and its peoples. This we ask through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We're now going to take our readings for today.
The first reading is taken from 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 6 to 10. Of course, there is great gain in godliness combined with contentment, for we have brought nothing into the world so that we can take nothing out of it. But if we have food and clothing, we will be content with these. But those who want to be rich fall into temptation and are trapped by many senseless and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. And in their eagerness to be rich, some have wandered away from the faith and pierced themselves with many pains. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Our second reading is taken from the Gospel according to Matthew, chapter 13, verses 34 and 35, and the verses 44 to 50. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus told the crowds all these things in parables. Without a parable, he told them nothing. This was to fulfill what had been spoken through the prophet. I will open my mouth to speak in parables. I will proclaim what has been hidden from the foundation of the world. Three parables. The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field, which someone found and hid. Then, in his joy, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls. On finding one pearl of great value, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was thrown into the sea and caught fish of every kind. When it was full, they drew it ashore, sat down, and put the good into baskets, but threw out the bad. So it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come out and separate the evil from the righteous and throw them into the furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Sorry about that. Not happy about being wrestled away. So it's lovely to be with you here today, and lovely to see so many people here to celebrate harvest with us. And if you're joining us online, it is lovely to have you with us in that way as well. And it's lovely too to see so many things given towards our collection that they'll go just to the benefit and bless so many people. If you did still want to donate, especially if you're watching online, we're going to be collecting donations in the South Porch until Friday, so do feel free to drop anything off during the week. Before I go any further, let's just take a moment to pause and pray. Father God, thank you for this time together today. Time to think about all the things we can be thankful for this harvest. Time to think about the world you have created and all of the things in it. Amen. And just again to say before I start, don't worry about noise. I have four boys and it would sound like my children are making the most noise anyway, so Parents, don't worry. So I was really pleased when Sean sent me some of the readings for today. The Timothy one is one that really gives me hope when we're reading it. And I actually paired it with a slightly different one from Matthew. Matthew 6, 25 to 33. Because I love the sense of peace that one gives me. And that passage starts, "Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life." Wow. And then we follow that up with, "Can you, by worrying, add a single hour to your span of life?" In other words, don't worry, God's got this. And I'll come back to the end of that passage in a moment. But then in the Timothy passage, and this is a letter probably written to someone called Timothy, who Christian tradition would say was the first bishop of Ephesus. And the letter is written to him and probably to his, maybe to his wider church or other leaders in his church. And the author of the letter is essentially giving advice about how to actually live a Christian life and make Christian communities were fairly new. So he's kind of giving his top tips on how to actually make being a Christian and living in this Christian community actually work. And the part of the letter we read today, the author remarks that there is great gain in godliness combined with contentment. So don't worry about seeking the more, work to be content with what we have. And that's quite easy to say, isn't it? But it's not, it's a lot harder to do. But at this time of harvest, we are often reminded, rightly so, to pause and take time to thank God for what we have, to be content with what we have. In a world when so many have so little, we can use this as an opportunity to say thank you. Thank you for our provisions, whatever they are. Thank you for food on the table. Thank you for each other. Thank you for fuel in the car. Thank you for safe drinking water that comes out of a tap in our homes. Thank you for clothes to wear, schools to attend, and safe place to live without fear of persecution. And this harvest, I also want us to spend a little bit of time thinking about the planet that we live on. As you may be aware, in about a month, something called COP26 is taking place. I have to admit, it wasn't actually something I knew a lot about until my six-year-old came home from school to tell me about this thing happening near where his cousins live about the weather. And I had to go and brush up my knowledge quite quickly so I could answer his questions and talk about what he'd been learning. So anyone in the same boat, COP26 is the 26th UN Climate Change of Parties Conference. Change Conference of Parties. Can't even read it properly. It's taking place in Glasgow at the beginning of November. They do have a very informative website if you're interested. In a very brief nutshell, this summit is designed to try and accelerate the action that is being taken to tackle climate change. I'm sure most of you are aware of the term climate change and the challenges it is creating, and the impact it's having on our world. And if you're not aware, then I think you probably will become aware over the next few months or possibly years. The Church of England itself has made a commitment to help all parts of the Church of England to become net zero by 2030. This means that they are committed to not adding more greenhouse gas emissions than they remove. They're committed to creating balance. They have even created an environment programme, which again is really worth looking up online. But here is just a brief video just introducing it.
This is something that goes back to the Bible and to the book of Genesis and the stories of creation. We're responding to the best of what scientists can tell us about what's happening on the Earth.
We're trying to make sure that our very special about what we're doing here. By not using concrete, we've saved over 70,000 kilograms of CO2.
Towards renewable energy, but I think there are some encouraging signs, but my God, we've got to work hard.
So I think it all sounds quite exciting and very in keeping with the times. But why? Why do we care? Isn't climate change a political thing? Or a thing for the Greta Thunbergs of this world? Why is it something that I should be concerned about as a Christian? Is it something that I especially need to be concerned about as a Christian? The simple answer is yes. Yes, I should be concerned. Yes, I should be concerned as a part of my Christian faith and life. And the why is actually, in many ways, pretty simple too. And although I'm sure I could spend hours working through different bits of scripture and relating them to why we should care about climate change, Archbishop Justin Welby sums it up saying, "Reducing the causes of climate change is essential to the life of faith. It is a way to love our neighbour and to steward the gift of creation." Wow. It sounds so simple, doesn't it? And I don't know about you, but if I'm being honest, I think sometimes I hear the term steward or stewardship and just assume it's a bit of a coverall or a bit of a buzzword. So do we know what it actually means for us in this context, in today's world? To explore that fully would probably take a long time and a healthy amount of debate, but we'll keep it simple today. Right at the start of the Bible, in the book of Genesis, we are told that humans have been given a very special, important, one-of-a-kind job. We are asked to be stewards of the earth. We are asked to look after our planet, the birds and animals, the plants, the seas and the lands of our world, as well as looking after each other. And if you combine these two roles, that means we are commanded to love our planet and everything in it for the sake of each other, for our children, for our children's children, for our neighbours, our friends, for people in other countries that we've never met but whose lives we impact with our actions and choices. We are all interconnected and interdependent. The Church of England's focus for this season of creation are centred around the Greek word oikos, which means home or family. And it's from this origin that we get our words that start with eco, like economics or ecology. The resources are encouraging us to explore how we are going to help renew the oikos of God that we have been asked to care for. In Genesis, as well as being asked to be stewards over the earth, we are told that God created a dome, under which all life has been placed. From the word dome stems words like domestic or domicile. We are all under that same dome roof. We are all in the same house, the same oikos of God. The Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. talked of the oikos of God as the beloved community, a community in which all things are equally members. Members with different roles, but all members. And I believe that this carefully balanced oikos of God has been disrupted by humans who have forgotten to share, who have forgotten to take care of their house and all those that live in it, who have forgotten that our actions have consequences and affect others, who have forgotten how to be good and effective stewards. And this is why climate change matters to Christians, to all people. Why it is important to be a part of things like EcoChurch, to take part in a challenge to become net zero. We are the generation that can set us on the path to renew the oikos of God, to begin the journey to return the world to God's original, fantastic creation. We can step back into the stewardship role designed for us when our all-creating God created the universe. And whilst that can seem like an insurmountable task, I truly believe that we can teach each other to do it together again. So going back to my Matthew 6 scripture, it would be easy to interpret this passage as saying, don't worry, sit back, enjoy your life, and I'll fix everything. But I don't believe that this would be a complete interpretation. The end of the passage states, but strive first for the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Strive first, before anything else. Strive means to make great efforts to achieve or obtain something, or to struggle or fight vigorously. So if we switch out kingdom for oikos, the end of the passage could be said as make it your priority to fight vigorously for the oikos of God, for the home of God. God has promised us all of creation, but in order to live in it fully, we need to remember to love it like he does. The very end of that passage that I haven't mentioned yet is the part that actually has already spoken to me the most. And it says, so do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will bring worries of its own. Today's trouble is enough for today. So yes, we need a plan to tackle climate change, to become net zero, to do all of those things. But we can also take it one day at a time. Take it a decision or a small change at a time. And we don't have to do it alone. We are doing it for the wider oikos, the beloved community of God living under this dome, and we get to do it together. And for that, I am truly thankful for this harvest time. I'm going to finish with a little quote from this book. I can thoroughly recommend it. It's written by Paul Carenza, and it's very funny. It's based on Noah's Ark, but it's God's promise and what we need to do next. And God made a promise to save our creation. So when we see animals, birds, vegetation, love and respect all that mooing and barking, and love this fine space that God's let us park in. Thank you.
Kate, thank you. A challenge to us all. We're going to stand and we're going to sing again. Our next song is Praise and Thanksgiving We Offer for All Things Living. You, God, have made good. Let us stand as we come and respond in worship. so we remain standing as we come and make our declaration of faith together. And so together we declare, we believe and trust in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named. We believe and trust in God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with his love. We believe and trust in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe and trust in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. If you'd like to please be seated, I believe I've got some helpers to now bring around some paper hands to you that we're going to be using for our prayers. And hopefully at the end of the pews, there should be a couple of pens and pencils for you. So what we're going to be doing is we're going to be pausing and thinking and using the hand to help us with our prayers. Now, children, we all know that hand has, you may correct me, I also say five fingers. You must want to tell me it's four fingers and a thumb. So whichever way we like to see that, there are five digits on our hands. And each of those, we're going to help us to think through different areas as we come to pray. The first one we're going to be thinking about is the world. You can use either your thumb or you can use your little finger for that. We're going to be using for the nation, so bringing it a bit close to us, and then thinking about us as church, the sick and the unwell, and then unity and peace. So the way it works is simply this. I'm going to give you a minute on each of those, and then we're going to just write down the finger the first one. Let's put down the word the world, and then start to write down our prayers, our hopes, and perhaps our fears that we want to lift to God this morning about our world and our planet as we come celebrating the harvest. So as you've got your pens, let's just begin slowly to do that. Places of home, or that wider sense of what it is to be part of this nation. Considering those who lead us, those who support us and encourage us, those who are simply there for us in so many different ways and in different places that each of us will inhabit throughout our lives. Let us now write the words, the church, or simply church. has called us together, both locally, nationally and internationally, to be his body, to be those who bring the good news of Jesus, and to be able to speak out on those issues that concern us all and demonstrate the love of God for all. Again, they may be our hopes, our fears, and all that we long, church, to be for us and for each other. Sick and unwell. And let us remember those who we are aware of, who are suffering at this time, whether it's in the body, the mind, or the spirit, and the turmoil and trauma that they may be facing. But let us also remember those who care for them, the family and friends who are lovingly supporting them, caring for them. Remembering our caring professions, the medical teams, the hospitals, all those who work tirelessly in and through our communities to ensure our well-being is good and maintained. So we come to that final finger. The words for us are unity and peace. Let's remember how it is that each of us is so interconnected with all others around us. Through the places where we live, our shared experiences, our hopes and our fears. Regardless of who we are or where we are. We all experience joy, sadness, sorrow, fun and laughter. And for many, some of those things may be simply taken away because of the places where they simply live. So let us work and cry out to God for that unity and peace for all peoples in all places. Take them and create something new for us. So I suggest you just gently bend the fingers away from you. And once you've done that, we simply begin to roll it round on itself. And you may need a bit of help. But it becomes almost a flower, a lily of the fields, which we are told in Scripture has more beauty than Solomon in all his fine clothes. And we encourage you to take your prayers with you this week. Maybe you can see the words that we've just written, and your prayers are held in the depth of this new creation. And may we know that God is in the business of creating and recreating. And our prayer is that for all those things that we've thought about, that we've written, that there will be signs of growth, of love, of hope, of peace. And may you take your flowers and enjoy them this week. Amen. I'm going to invite you to stand as we come and share the words of the peace together. If you'd like to please stand. We are reminded that the harvest of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. So let us share with one another the abundance of the harvest gift. And may the peace of the Lord be always with you and also with you. And let us share that peace of God with those immediately next to us and around us as we lift each other into the arms of our loving God. And for those who are joining us online, may the peace of God be always with you. As we prepare the table to receive the bread and the wine, we're going to continue in our sung worship by singing again, "We eat the plants that grow from seed." So we pray. The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. It is right to praise you, Father, Lord of all creation. In your love, you made us for yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son. You embraced us as your children and welcomed us to sit and eat with you. In Christ, you shared our life, that we might live in him and he in us. He opened his arms of love upon the cross and made for all the perfect sacrifice for sin. On the night he was betrayed, he had supper with his friends. He took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of life. At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for all. As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son. As we eat and drink these holy gifts in the one in Christ, our risen Lord, with your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of praise and lift our voice to join the eternal song of heaven. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Let us sit or kneel as we continue in prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Come to the table of Jesus, our Redeemer. Jesus invites you here to be part of the people of God. Come to the table humbly, not because you have earned a place here, but because you need mercy and help. Come because you love God and want to love God more. Come because Jesus first loved us and gave himself for us. Come because you want to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Come because you want to experience the mystery of God's grace. God, we come to you, remembering and giving thanks for your Son. Bless and pour your Spirit on us as we receive these simple things, bread and wine. Nourish us, revive and strengthen us as we come to your table. Amen. The body of Christ. The blood of Christ. We have come to the Lord's table. We have eaten the bread of heaven. We pray together, Lord of the harvest, with joy we have offered thanksgiving for your love in creation and have shared in the bread and the wine of the kingdom. By your grace, plant within us a reverence for all that you give us and make us generous and wise stewards of the good things we enjoy through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Just a reminder, refreshments are served at the end of our time here together in worship. We do hope you're able to stay and join us as we continue in fellowship. But now let us stand and come and sing that wonderful hymn of praise. Come, ye thankful people, come. Raise the song of harvest home. May God, our Creator, who clothes the lilies and feeds the birds of the air, bestow on you his care and increase the harvest of your righteousness. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Sorry, Kath, I haven't quite finished. It's quite all right. Some final words for us all. Freely you have received, freely give. Go in peace to love and to serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, amen.
Thank you.